Good morning. Good morning. Father, thank you for this place that you have given to us to gather. It is certainly our prayer as we come every Sunday that we would hear from you, not just putting in our time, but really seeking after our God, and that you might bless your people this morning, that we might truly, Lord, know that you have spoken to our hearts, that we would leave this place encouraged and hopeful, remembering, Lord, what you've taught us. And may it change the way we live. So go before us. Make yourself known to everyone who comes in today, tonight as well. And Lord, may you be glorified in this place in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Let's all stand and let's worship the Lord together.
Rising up all around, it's the end.
Seated.
What's up, Second Service? Good to see you guys this morning. We're going to be in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5 this morning. We're going to be looking at knowing the times and God's Word. Outstanding study this morning as we consider the times in which we live. If you have your bulletin, grab it. We're going to go through it, look at it together. There's a lot of announcements, so as the Lord leads you, lock in and we'll look at what God has for us. But we'd like to welcome you. It's a good day to be in church, God's people, under God's Word about God's Son by the power of God's Spirit. So we're here gathered together to see our King. Likewise, tonight, Pastor Jack is going to be wrapping up the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 16 as we look at final thoughts from Paul. And as you know, if you read through Paul's letters, Paul always finishes well. So you want to be here tonight for that study. Likewise, on Wednesday night, we're looking at the flood. We're looking at Genesis 7 through 8. So last time we just got our feet wet a little bit, and there's far more water this time as we look at Genesis 7 and 8. The flood on Wednesday night. Likewise, we're having our communion service this Wednesday at 7 p.m. right here. As the Lord leads you, we'd love it if you join together with the family as we celebrate the shed blood, the broken body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ together, and the cross that he bore on our behalf. So that'll be this Wednesday. As he leads you, please join with us for that. Parents of high schoolers, we have our Shine Conference that's coming up very soon. Today is the last day for sign-ups for that. So you want to grab information for that back in the foyer. You can go sign up for that in room 3. What the Shine Conference is, it's a worship conference meant to deepen your high schoolers' understanding of Jesus. So they're going to deepen their knowledge of Jesus. It's a great opportunity for them as the Lord leads you. We'd love it if you joined us for that. Again, today's the last day for that, though. Also, we have on Thursday, May the 3rd, we have our National Day of Prayer, and we've done it differently in the past. We've met early in the morning, and so this year we're not doing it that way. We're going to meet right here in the main sanctuary at 7 p.m. Child care will be provided through the 6th grade, just to make it more accessible for you, God's family. So we're going to come together and lift up the needs of our country, of our church, of our churches, of our city, those who serve our city. We're going to lift up the needs of our land, pray for a healing work in our land by the Holy Spirit. So we'd love it if you joined us there for that, for the National Day of Prayer. Also on Friday, May the 4th, we're going to be headed out to Watts to come alongside Hope Central of Watts. That is a church there, Calvary Chapel in the city, that is ministering to the city. They have a Friday night youth outreach that actually the city has asked them to run. And so we get to come in and serve that happening. So plenty of opportunities to fellowship, to spend time with the church that is there, likewise, to outreach and to minister to the many, many youth that come and share the gospel with them, both with life and lips. So as the Lord leads you, 4 p.m. on Friday the 4th, we're headed over there. So out of the Chapel Store parking lot that is over beyond the fellowship hall. Likewise, on Sunday, May the 6th, we're having and starting our potlucks again on Sunday night. So Sunday, May the 6th, will be our Mexican potluck. My personal favorite, that is, so you can grab a flyer for that and find out all the information that you need to know about how you can bring food that night. We'll come in here and we'll enjoy the real food of God's Word, and then likewise we'll head over afterwards to enjoy fellowship with the family together and see what God might do amongst us in our midst. So invite somebody. That's a great night to invite somebody to church and fellowship with the body. So also we have our new believers class that is coming up very soon. It's been really cool because so many people recently have gotten saved. It's been really awesome to watch. Continue to pray for that. God's doing amazing stuff here at Morningstar. But for those those of you who are new believers, it's a great opportunity for you. It's really essential to get the basics of the faith and how to walk with Jesus and have a relationship with Him. That's coming up Thursday, May the 10th. It's a six-week course on just the basics of the faith to get grounded again. Or maybe you've just rededicated your life to the Lord. Also a great opportunity for you to plug into that. We have a parenting seminar that's coming up on Saturday, May the 19th. Dr. Scott Taransky will be here to give us some practical ideas on how to shepherd the hearts of our children as we seek to pastor the hearts of our kids into the things of God, to lead them to Jesus and shepherd them in that way. So we're going to have a lot of opportunity to learn just some practical aspects of that. That's Saturday, May the 19th. You can sign up for that online or at the information counter at the back as God leads you, parents. Also, we have our college and young adults retreat that is coming up very soon, the summer retreat. It happens on May the 31st through June the 2nd. So if you're 18 to 25, great opportunity for you. Our theme this year is the person and the work of the Holy Spirit. And we definitely need the power of the Holy Spirit to live Christian lives. So as the Lord leads you, you can sign up for that online at the information counter or in the bookstore or in the church office during the week. We also have a short-term missions trip that you've heard a lot about that is coming up June 21st to the 28th. Our team is headed to Hermosillo, Mexico in the state of Sonora to come alongside our supported missionaries, Jeff and Lelia Rowanspee, who've planted a church there. And so we want to come alongside them and serve that church as they make Jesus' name great in Hermosillo. So you can sign up for that online. Applications are due, but there are still a few spots. So as the Lord leads you, we'd love it if you joined us for that. You can grab information for it at the information counter. Finally, we have, for those of you guys who want to be pastors, church planters, missionaries, elders, serve the work of God going forward through the teaching of God's Word. Our Morningstar School of Ministry is taking applications for the 2012 school year. Your application deadline is August the 3rd. You can grab information in a pamphlet back at the back information counter and sign up for that online. The entire application is available online. God bless you guys.
It's a mini service these days, those announcements, right? My goodness, there's a lot of them. All right, let's open our Bibles to Psalm 96 this morning. We're going to read Psalm 96. I'll read the odd-numbered verses. You can read the even-numbered ones. Let's stand together and read God's Word out loud. Psalm 96. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, and sing to the Lord all the earth. And declare his glory among the nations, his wonders among all people.
The Lord is great, and great is his grace. He is the creator of all gods.
For all the gods of the people are idols, but the Lord made the heavens.
Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary.
So give to the people, O family, give to the Lord, O families of the peoples, and give to the Lord glory and strength. And worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness and tremble before him, all the earth.
Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. The world also is firmly established. It shall not be moved. It shall judge the peoples righteously.
And let the heavens rejoice and the earth be glad and the sea roar in all of its fullness. For he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the people with truth. Father, this morning, like the psalmist, we are here to worship you, to sing a new song, to bless the Lord, to exalt your name, to declare your glory, to say in our hearts before you that you are great and greatly to be praised, and that honor and majesty belong to you, and how you have blessed us, how you have taught us your ways. May we, Lord, worship here and then step out of this place and be a witness for you, especially in these days when we know that any day now the Lord may come. He'll come to judge the world. He'll deliver his people, but the world will face judgment. So stir our hearts. May we take your word to every place and warn them, Lord, of your love and tell them of your goodness. And yet, Lord, be those witnesses. So go before us this morning, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a baby dedication this morning. If Evan and Corinne Ford will bring little Jackson. You know, these baby dedications are getting harder. These kids all have more hair than I do, and they're like two. How old is this guy?
10 months.
10 months. Look, more hair than I got. How you doing, buddy? He's cute, huh? I know. Headbutt me. See that? He does a headbutt. Father, we lift up Jackson to you this morning. So thankful, Lord, for putting him into a family that loves you. And for Evan and Corinne, we do pray your hand would be upon them, that you would not only provide all that they need, but you would give them, Lord, abundantly so, all that they need to make sure this young man grows up to know you. And Lord, it is our prayer this morning that for Jackson, he might, Lord, be a man of God, a young man after your heart, a work of your spirit, that you might not only protect him and look over him and watch over him, but that you, Lord, would send him out, that he would be a light in a dark place, that his life and his love for you would be quickly developed as he watches mom and dad walk with Jesus. So we lift up the Ford family. Thank you, Lord, for this work that you've begun. We know you're going to finish and do great things in Jackson's life, and that's our prayer as we lift him up before you this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. He's got the study right there. Go see mom. Go see. No, you can take that with you. Okay, buddy. God bless you, man. Good to see you. God bless
you,
mom.
Thank you.
Okay. Here, take this.
Thank you.
All right.
Be lifted up. Be lifted up as we bow down. Be lifted up. Be lifted up. Be lifted up as we bow down. Be lifted.
We lift you up.
We lift you up. We lift you up. As we bow down, we lift you up. We lift you up. We lift you up.
Let the heavens rejoice.
The heavens rejoice. Let the nations be glad. Let the whole earth tremble. For you are God. And we'll worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let the heavens rejoice. Let the nations be glad. The whole earth tremble, for you are God, and we'll worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness.
Let
the heavens rejoice, let the nations be glad, let the whole earth tremble, for you are God, and we'll worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. We lift you up as we bow down. We lift you up
as we bow down.
As we bow down, we lift you up.
Heavenly Father, we come before you humbly, praying with Moses that great prayer out of Exodus 33. Show me now your glory. We want to see your glory. And we know that you've spoken to us in these last days in the person of your Son, the expressed image of his person, the brightness of your glory, incarnate amongst us, to walk amongst us, that we might understand him and we might understand you. He took our sins, gave us forgiveness. And now, very soon, he's going to return. We can't wait to see his glory. We ask that in these last days we would walk circumspectly as we bring to you our tithes and our offerings. We want them to make much of you because the time is short. We can't wait to see your son. It's in Jesus' name we pray.
Your beauty is all that I long for. To worship you, Jesus, is my sole desire. For this very heart you have shaped for your pleasure, and purpose to lift your name high. Here in surrender, in pure adoration, I enter your courts with an offering of praise. I am your servant, come to bring you glory, as is fit for the work of your hand. Now unto the Lamb, who sits on the throne, be glory and honor and praise. All of creation resounds with a song, worship and praise Him, the Lord of. Living and dwelling within me, keep my eyes fixed ever on Jesus' face. Let not the things of this world ever sway me, or until I finish the race. Come to the Lamb who sits on the throne, be glory and honor and creation resounds with a song, worship and praise the Lord. Now unto the Lamb who sits on the throne, be glory and honor and praise. All of creation resounds with a song, worship and praise Him, the Lord. Let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer, this is my plea. Father, I see that you would draw me, line in the sand. I want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer.
A brand new
ransom. The debt is paid. His chains are gone. Emmanuel, God with us. Such a tiny offering compared to Calvary. Nevertheless, laid at your feet. Such a tiny offering compared to Calvary. Nevertheless, laid at your feet. A brand new song. The debt is paid. His chains are gone. Emmanuel, God with us.
Yes, Lord Jesus. Oh, praise you, Lord God. And Lord, we thank you that we can sing that. That you, Lord, came, took on flesh, dwelt among us. Became that perfect sacrifice for us, Lord. Emmanuel, God with us. And now in your presence, Lord, as we turn to your word, may we know by your Holy Spirit, your voice, your desire, your command for our hearts. May we walk in obedience to it.
Yes, God.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. All right, shall we open our Bibles this morning to the second letter of Paul to the Thessalonians, chapter 2, verse 1. 2 Thessalonians 2, 1. I'd like to continue this morning this second letter that Paul wrote to this young church, and we've spent a lot of time between this letter and the first one to know that when Paul went to Europe for the first time, he spent some time in Philippi and then ended up 100 miles away here. And though it was a very large city with maybe a couple of 100,000 people living in it, it was on the Ignatian Road, it was on a major trade highway, it was a port city, it had all of the idols known to man, it was a very decadent place. Paul got to spend all of 3 weeks there before wicked religious men hired thugs to drag the fellow Jason out of his house where Paul had been staying and threaten him with death, and Paul and his boys were down the road. And Paul really continued that way for quite some time. By the time he got to Corinth, he was as discouraged as someone could be. But yet, Paul sent Timothy back to see how this church was doing, and when he got news months later that things were fine. It was Paul who wrote or Luke that wrote of Paul in chapter 18 of Acts, verse 5, that Paul was invigorated. And finally, after months of just kind of wondering if the Lord could use him, he stood up and began to preach with great conviction, and God began to greatly bless. So he wrote the first letter then to encourage them. It was the first letter that he wrote of the New Testament letters that we have. A couple of months later, still in Corinth, he writes this letter. And he writes it for a couple of reasons. He wants to reiterate some of the things he had taught them. But also there had been a great confusion entered the church. Back in 1 Thessalonians 4 and 5, Paul had talked to great length about the rapture of the church and God coming for the saints and the tribulation that would follow, the Great Tribulation and all. But since that Paul had left, there'd been a lot of false teachers rolling into town. They had produced a letter that had Paul's name on it, although he hadn't written one, that said that they had just plain out missed the rapture altogether and the suffering that they were going through. And there was a lot of it there. Was really the Great Tribulation, and now they would have to suffer through it. And so Paul writes this second letter a few months later just to focus on the hope of God's return, to correct some of those misconceptions, to reiterate the things that he had taught them, to clear up the confusion and all. But it does interest me that Paul, in 3 weeks of staying with this young church as God began to work, included in the basics of the faith the things that were coming, the rapture, the tribulation. He is able to say in verse 5, which is kind of the lesson of this morning, remember what I told you. You know, that I taught you these things, but he taught them to him in just a few weeks and then kind of supported them in that first letter that he wrote. It is certainly important that you and I know the timeline of things that are to come. You shouldn't just take someone's word for it. You should know what's next on the calendar, on God's calendar. What's coming next and why will that come next? And in what order will that come and why? And where do you fall into all of those things? So it is amazing to me that with the amount of weird teaching going on, that we aren't more convinced of what we believe and why. And that we need to have an answer for the hope that lies within us. In chapter 1, Paul spoke specifically to the saints about their suffering and said, you know, when the Lord comes for you, you're going to find rest with him. You hang in there. It's worth waiting. And these who are now making your life miserable and these folks that are going after you, they're going to find the judgment of God. God's going to write these things. He may not write them at this moment or even in your lifetime, but when he comes, certainly all of the books will be balanced and God knows what you're going through, so stick with it. This morning, we'd like to just look at the first 5 verses of chapter 2 as Paul spoke to them about the lies that had been told, encourages them to remember what they'd been taught, and then wants them to know that the Great Tribulation is not here because the rapture comes first, and then they'll be taken out. I should mention to you, if Paul was a post-tribulation guy, a guy that teaches like some do today, that the church is going to go through the tribulation and somehow their deliverance is going to come at the end, then this wouldn't have been a concern for this church. They would have just said, hey, we're closer to the coming of the Lord. But they were concerned because they thought they'd missed out on the deliverance God had promised. So Paul wasn't a post-tribulation guy, I assure you. Verse 1 says this, now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled either by your spirit or by word or by a letter as if it had come from us, as though the day of Christ had come. Let no one deceive you by any means. That day will not come unless the falling away comes first and that man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and he exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you all of these things? History certainly records countless wicked leaders, you know, from Cain early on to Saddam Hussein more recently, from Hitler to Stalin to Nero in Paul's day, to Domitian in John's day, to Assad in Syria in your day. There are always countless men who are willing to destroy the lives of others at, you know, their at their whim, and develop their lives based upon bloodshed, upon on anger and violence. It's just life in a world fallen into sin. It is not much different in church history. There have been countless would-be Christs, false prophets, cult leaders, gurus and swamis, and countless other charlatans who blow through the world as, you know, wolves, pack of wolves in sheep's clothing. Yet there is coming a man who will make all of the others look like child's play. The most wicked man to ever walk the face of the earth, filled with Satan and known by a whole bunch of names. He is called the little horn by Daniel, the prince that is to come, the king who does what he pleases. Daniel refers to him as a terrible beast in chapter 7. Zechariah in chapter 11 calls him a worthless shepherd. John refers to him as the beast in Revelation. He is probably no better known than by the name that only John gives him in the little letters at the end of your Bible. He calls him the Antichrist. It's a compound word that defines this final world ruler who will seek at the end of time to establish himself as God, to get God out of the way, to have men follow and bow down and worship him. The very thing that caused his fall will dominate him to the very end when the Lord will come. Throughout history, when men raise up or women raise up or others to declare themselves to be God, John writes in 1 John chapter 2 that the Antichrist denies the Father and the Son, that there are already many spirits that have gone out into the world. There are already many Antichrists. It's really that moving of Satan against God. Since the fall of man, the time of Adam and Eve, God promised that one day he would send a Savior. He said specifically to the devil, there will be one coming, the seed of the woman, who will crush your head. Those are fighting words, right? And if you're the devil, you're not going to take that lying down. And he hasn't. Since that day, there has been an all-out war between God and this fallen angel who will one day, you know, come to fruition in the Antichrist and then will find his ultimate demise. But there has been a battle. And the Bible records much of this wickedness of the enemy that is directed towards the Lord, towards his people, towards the nation of Israel, towards the church, and towards his son. By the time that Noah comes around, and there are only 1,656 years between when Adam and Eve fell and when the flood came. The world had become so corrupt and demonized that God destroyed it with a flood. Only saved 8 folks. Noah and his wife, his 3 sons and their wives. Later in Egypt, Satan instigated a policy of killing the newborn sons in Exodus 1 because, you know, the Israelites, a captive people, had become so numerous that the Egyptians worried that they might just overwhelm them with numbers. And so the plan came, you have a son, he dies. And it was during that time, you remember, Moses was born and God protected him. 600 years later, in the lineage of this promised one who would crush the serpent's head, the hope of that line was reduced in 2 Chronicles 22 to one guy, a young man named Joash, who was hidden because his wicked grandmother, Athaliah, had decided that she should just destroy the line completely. And had this little boy not been taken and hidden, that promise of God would not have been fulfilled. It was certainly an attack of the enemy. Later on, Satan took Haman's heart and sought in Esther chapter 3 the annihilation of the Jews. It failed because God raised up Esther and raised up Mordecai, faithful man and woman who sought the Lord and put themselves where they should be, and God used them. When Jesus was born and the wise men came to Herod to ask where he that is to be born king of the Jews would be born, they wanted spiritual direction. Herod heard the promise and he decreed the slaughter of every male child in the area in Bethlehem, 2 years old and under. He wanted to be sure he'd wiped him out. He failed because God moved Mary and Joseph to Egypt. He spared them as they escaped the slaughter, but no doubt the enemy again sought to wipe out what God had begun. And when Jesus comes upon the scene, wherever he turned, with all of the folks who loved him and listened to him, they were constantly trying to throw him off a cliff or stone him with stones. And certainly at the cross, Satan thought, well, I finally got him. Well, that lasted till Sunday. And then he realized otherwise. But Satan hates God. He hates God's purposes. He hates God's people. And he hates the Jews, the ones through whom God sent his son, and the one through whom he will rule during the Great Tribulation. So, you know, you find the Jews are subject of demonic hatred in every generation. The Holocaust of the past century, the radical Islamic calls for the destruction of their nation are all just preludes to what the Antichrist will one day want to do or seek to do. So he's the one that certainly will one day come and lead the world astray, but that will come far after you and I have been taken and gathered to the Lord. Paul, in writing to this young church, addresses their worry or their lack of joy or their lack of hope, because now they had been taught and told by forgetting what God had said through Paul to them that maybe they'd missed out on the deliverance that God would bring through the rapture. Now they had found themselves in this life of judgment from God that would eventually find his coming. But did we miss it? And Paul says no. But their conclusions were based on the false teaching that had been sent their way. And they couldn't distinguish between the rapture, which the Bible teaches us is will occur at any moment, is for the church, is not on the ground but in the clouds, is a time when you get new bodies if you and translated and you'll so ever be with the Lord. And then the second coming of Jesus, which is predicted on a very specific day and can be figured out once the church has been taken out. And it will be upon the earth and it will be where the Lord will rule and reign for 1,000 years. So Paul's word to them in verse 5 is, don't you remember? Don't you remember us going over this in great detail? And indeed, he did. It is vital, I think, that you and I understand the order of things to come, that the church age, the age you and I live in, this age of grace, will end with the rapture of the church. When Daniel in chapter 9 was given by the Lord God's timetable for his dealing with Israel, he was given this 490-year period whereby God would accomplish all that he intended to, the first coming and the second coming of his son. And in between that 69 7-year periods, which were accomplished up to the time of the Lord's coming, and the last 7 years, the Great Tribulation, is this church age that you find in the middle. And it's known by a lot of different names. It is called Jacob's Trouble in Jeremiah chapter 30. It's called the Great Tribulation in Daniel chapter 9. But it is that time when God, having removed you and I as the church his own out of the world, he will bring his final, really, dealing with man in his unbelieving position, and he will do so by renewing his work through Israel. Now, there's a lot we know about the Great Tribulation. We know it's exactly 2,520 days long, seven times the 360-day Babylonian calendar that all biblical prophecy is kind of predicated upon. If you have any trouble with any of that, you should go back and listen to the Daniel 9 studies, or you should have been in with us for the whole year we did Revelation on Wednesday nights. We know from Daniel 9 that the Antichrist will come to make a deal, a covenant with Israel for 7 years, that he will come on the scene very glibly. The Bible describes him as having a bow without arrows. He's a good talker. He's a winsome guy. Daniel describes that as well. He will basically fool the world into following him, but it'll be after you and I have been taken out. It follows the rapture of the church in Revelation 4 and 5. And he will go at this for 3.5 years. He will help Israel build their place of worship again, the temple. He will broker that deal with all of the Arab countries as well. He will look to be a savior and a deliverer and a winner. He is described in Revelation 6, 1 and 2 as the one who rides on the white horse, but he's not Jesus. He just wants to act that way. In the middle of that time, at the 1260-day mark, exactly in the middle, the prophet Daniel describes it as time, times, and half a time, or 3.5 times. Revelation chapter 12 describes it that way as well. I think we're also told it is 42 months. It's told to be 1260-day in Revelation 13. In any event, right in the middle, right in the middle of that seven-year period, the Antichrist will no longer be the deceiver. He will turn to what he really is. He is the devil come to take worship from man. He'll show up at the temple. He'll cause the worship to stop and the sacrifices. He'll demand to be worshipped. He'll sign an edict that says you don't take his mark on your hand or your forehead. You're going to be killed. You won't be able to buy and sell. You'll be ostracized and isolated. It is his final pitch for glory. It will bring from heaven all that you read between Revelation 6 and chapter 18. It'll bring the judgment of God to bear. It is called the abomination of desolation by Daniel. Jesus uses the exact same words to describe the exact same time in Matthew chapter 24 as Satan comes and says, look, I want to be worshipped. So you read through chapter 18 of Revelation, and nearly everything after Revelation 6:2 takes place in those last 3.5 years. Though there are a couple of looks back, there are a couple of undefined events, but beyond that, the focus is on, you know, this man of sin. And Revelation 19 shows Jesus then coming back to wipe him out in a moment's time. But if you want to know more about the Antichrist, read Daniel 7 and 8 and 9 and 10 and 11, where it speaks about his methods and how his winning ways, you know, and his pompous words and his blasphemous attitude take root. And by the time you get to Daniel 11 and 12, one day his judgment as well. So it is to that subject and timeline that Paul turns the hearts of these young saints in Thessalonica to say, look, your fears are groundless. The false teachers are just that, they're false. That phony letter is not mine. And I've taught you already these things. Remember them. Remember them. You know, I think it's interesting that we suffer, I think, the most when we forget what we know. When we lose sight, you know, you get a lot of information, and what gets in your head doesn't really stay with you. It needs to get in your heart, right? Like I remembered my phone number for years because I used it all the time. And then we got cell phones, and people go, what's your number? I go, I don't know. It's right there. Because I didn't use it anymore. You know, I didn't look at it. I'll go to websites that I use all the time that require you to sign in, and I'm glad my computer remembers who I am. Because if it ever, like, goes bad, and they go, what is your, I don't know. Hi, I don't know. I need to get in there. My stuff, you know. Because I don't use it.
And I find it interesting that Paul, in his great love for these folks, was heartbroken that they were suffering so much because people were lying to them and they were buying it, because they couldn't somehow take the truth and stand with it. He calls them his brethren in verse 1, family. And the words "ask you" at the end of verse 1 means, I want to beg you. I just want to plead with you. Don't let people fool you so quickly. The reason they were susceptible to false teaching is that, verse 5, they had forgotten what God had said. Look, I don't want you to be confused or lied to about the coming of the Lord, how he comes to be near you. Parousia means to be near physically. It is translated, I think, twice presence, 22 times coming in the New Testament. But it always speaks of the presence of someone. Here in verse 1 and 2, the rapture of the church. In verse 9, the presence physically of the Antichrist. In verse 8, the physical presence of Jesus. Instead of having great hope that he was coming for them and that providing daily relief from all that they were going through, these saints had lost sight of the fact that the Lord could come at any moment. And instead of looking up with joy, their suffering just became worse. Oh, not only are we going through it like crazy, but there's no relief inside. There's no hope that we can hang our hat on. And they were susceptible to these lies and all. And Paul said, look, I would beg you not to be so troubled or shaken by spirit, by word, by letter, as if somehow we sent it to you that the day of Christ had come. It hasn't. You're still here. Soon shaken, you know, you can subvert people's lives if you'll just lie to them. And no sooner had Paul written letter one, and it's only been 90 days ago, 120 days ago, than in comes the enemy with all of this junk, you know, to try to turn away the hearts of the people. And Paul said, like, don't be so gullible. You know better. The effect of false teaching from people who claim spiritual insight or have letters or insights you don't have is that you can lose your joy. Why is it so important that you believe the right things? Because the truth of God brings life. Information doesn't. God's word sets us free, right? The truth indeed. But you need to know it. Or you're easily going to be a subject of Satan's hatred. And by the way, he hates you and the God that you serve. And his campaign is always to destroy that which God has begun. So here's a young church who's doing great. Paul was so encouraged. And it isn't 90 days later, he says, look, don't be so bummed out. Why do you lose your composure? Why are you so frightened? Why have you lost the hope of Jesus' coming? Why are you now filled with anxiety and fear? And the reason is, you've been listening to the wrong people and you've forgotten the truth of God. And it shouldn't be like that. Don't be fooled. God will come for you first, then all of these things will take place. Let no man deceive you. You know, that's the problem with spiritual living, is that the enemy wants to deceive you. Jesus said in Matthew 24, verse 4, the exact same word, let no man deceive you. Because we are constantly facing an enemy who comes around like an angel of light, and he's got his degree, and he's got a TV program, he's got a Bible, he must be telling the truth. But he's not. And the whole part of deception is you don't see it coming, right? To be deceived means you didn't see it coming. And we're not in the dark about the devil. We should see it coming. And the best way we can do it is go back to verse 5 and remember what we've been taught. To be wrong about the rapture and the day of the Lord has serious consequence, because now you no longer find yourself living for the Lord. Peter said, look, if we see that this day is coming, how can we live? And John writes, and he's 90 years old, we don't yet see the Lord, but we know that when he comes, we're going to be like he is. We're going to see him as he is. And if you have this hope in you, you'll purify yourself. But you see, you lose sight of that. And there's no longer a purifying effect. If you don't really believe the Lord could come today, you live any way you want. You can say, well, he might come, but I doubt it. He hasn't come yet. I haven't seen him. I don't even think he knows where we are. You know, I don't know. Not going to have much of a purifying effect. But if you think he's coming today, and someone goes, hey, you want to go here? No, because the Lord could come. I don't want him to catch me with that, doing that. Purifying effect. These folks had lost sight of the truth. There is a day of Christ when he will come for his own, and there is a day of the Lord when he will bring judgment. The term day of the Lord is a big phrase in the Bible. It starts with the day that the church is gathered up by the Lord. It ends at the end of the thousand-year reign of Christ upon the earth. That's a huge bit of time. It is defined only in the context in which it is used. So Paul speaks about the rapture in verse 1 and 2. He then turns to the Great Tribulation and says that, look, the one hasn't come, the rapture, and you're not in the other, because one has to precede the other. Which ought to convince you, if it hasn't, that you need to know
the sequence of events. You ought to be able to tell folks, here's what comes next. And the key is, remember. It has to be, we stay in the Bible. We learn, and it gets from our head 18 inches down to our hearts. You know, it becomes a part of our life. We should have a better grasp on it than ever before. And it does seem to me, and maybe to you as well, if you've been a Christian for 5 or 10 years, you're probably not going to hear anything new. You're not going to hear something go, oh, I never knew that. No, you probably knew. It's all going to become a matter of remembering, right? I have in my office 22,000 pages typed, single-spaced, of Bible study through the entire Bible, from Genesis 1 to Revelation 22. Years of studying and typing and keeping notes, they're there. So when I go to study a new book, I take all of my old notes and then I take new books that I haven't read and I put those together and I spend time with them. But here's my unfortunate response to my notes. I'll get a note and I'll go, dude, that is awesome. Like I've never read it before. I wrote it. When did I learn this? And maybe more importantly, when did I forget this? And I'm constantly amazed and thrilled at what I've read and written before. That's not good. Now, part of that might be age. I don't know. But I suspect that was the same thing when I was 20 years younger. It just seems to be we forget what we know. My father used to say, you know, I've forgotten more than you know. Remember that old line? I've forgotten more than you'll ever know. Oh, thanks, Dad. That's great. I think he's telling me the truth. I've just forgotten more. That's all I remember. That's the only part I know. And so Paul said, look, didn't you remember? Don't you remember? You know, Paul had taught them that this day of the Lord wouldn't come, this judgment of God, the great tribulation, until this falling away comes first. Now, it's important that you understand which falling away that he's talking about, because this falling away presents the man of sin. The church has taken 3.5 years of his hustle have passed, and then the man of sin is revealed. Now the word falling away is the basic word turning away or blasphemy or apostasy. That would be what the word would be. But it is used in lots of contexts. There are lots of precursors to the Great Tribulation. There have always been apostasies, people turning away. And I think the only other place this word is used is in Acts chapter 21, where it talks about people forsaking the law of Moses, turning away from God's law. But the church has always seen a measure of apostasy. Apostasy, by definition, means that you turn away from a position once held to another position or a belief once held. It doesn't necessarily mean you were a believer. It just means you believed one thing and then you turn and you became a believer in something else that is totally contrary to what you once believed. You know, the Laodicean church in Revelation 3 certainly had its apostates. They were in church, but they were hardly believers. But that's not the falling away Paul has in mind here. That's a natural consequence of sin. Not everybody is who they say they are. People fool themselves. They fool others. You know, Jesus said, you'll know them by their fruits, because there's some who are sitting in church that aren't saved in the least, but they're there every week. They fool everyone but the Lord. And maybe they've even fooled themselves. This falling away is an act of blasphemy that is unprecedented in magnitude. In fact, it reveals the man of sin. It is not a general trend or a flow of rebellion. It is a specific, identifiable act associated with a man of sin, the wicked one, the Antichrist, who will yet be revealed. When will he be revealed? At the 3.5 year mark, right? When for 3.5 years he's been Israel's friend, he's been the peacemaker, he's been a guy you can count on, hey, make a deal with me, sign a covenant, my word is good. And then in the middle of that time, he shows himself for who he is. Oh my gosh. You're who? Yes, that's me. Worship me. And the devil steps forward. And man realizes their sin, but now it's too late. And it is his turning, it is his absolute apostasy, if you will, that becomes the overwhelming, you know, truth to the world. Oh my goodness. That's the falling away that reveals this man of sin. And the word revealed is in the aorist tense here. It means at a very definitive time in history, this revelation will take place. His true character will be seen. He'll come to the temple and he'll say, no more worship. You worship me. And for 3.5 years, this friend of Israel who helped them build their temple will suddenly cast them aside. And according to Revelation, even the church, the visible church, not the believers, but the churchgoers at that time who will support him will be discarded by him. So notice he's called here the man of sin, the son of perdition,
pretty dubious titles. It means the son of ruin or destruction. Only one other guy in the Bible named that. You know who that is, right? Judas. The two vilest guys in the entire Bible given the same title, empowered by the same devil, headed for destruction in the same manner. So this falling away is sure to come as the church is removed, preparing the way for this man of sin. And the Great Tribulation will be marked at least for 3.5 years by everyone rallying behind one guy, only to find out when he's revealed that he's not at all what we thought that he was. He'll be energized by Satan, possessed by the devil, aided by a false prophet, and demand world worship and declare death to those who refuse. And from that day forward, 1260 days, Jesus will return. You can count on it. It'll be that day. Now, Paul says to these Thessalonians, since that hasn't happened yet, you can rest assured you're not living in that day. In fact, that will never happen for you. You'll be taken out before all of these things begin. You will never, I am convinced, know who the Antichrist is. If you read prophecy books, depending on which generation they were written in, you will find people telling you who the Antichrist is. You know, if it was written in the 40s, for a long time it was Mussolini, and then he died, and then it was Hitler. And if you read modern books, you'll find a lot of suggestions as to who he might be, depending on your political persuasion or your ethnic background or your, you know, I'm sure he's the Antichrist. You'll never know. You shouldn't be looking for the Antichrist. You should be looking for the Lord Jesus Christ, because he's the one that's coming next. That's the next step. And the minute the church is taken out, the age of grace finishes, and that seven-year clock begins to tick, and 7 years to the day later, Jesus will return riding on a white horse, all right, but it'll be the Lord. And out of his mouth will go the word of God, and you'll get to ride with him and return to rule and reign. Next week, Paul will conclude this topic by talking about how the Holy Spirit today is restraining the work of the devil. It's a great topic, something you should know. You know, people go, the world's getting worse. Just think about what happens when you and the work of God's Spirit and restraining are taken out of the way, when there's nothing to say, don't do this. I'm going to start a campaign for no zippers on Bibles. I'm just kidding, don't worry. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you this morning for your good word to us and how it is important that we, as your people, should be aware of the days in which we live, to have an answer for the hope that lies within us, and certainly, Lord, to be able to stand against so often that weird teaching that we get about tribulation and us and facing God's wrath, and set aside your word, which clearly tells us that though the tribulation in our life comes from Satan and from the world and from the flesh, in the great tribulation it's coming from the throne of God. It'll be his judgment poured out upon unbelieving men. And we've been delivered from the wrath of God. We have a great hope. One day you're going to come and call us to yourself, and the trumpet will sound, and the dead in Christ will rise first, and then those who are alive and remain will be caught up with him together in the clouds. So shall we ever be with the Lord. And Father, that's our prayer. That's our hope. But we realize as we look in our nation today that we are certainly closing in on the coming of the Lord, that there's really nothing now to keep you from coming. We see Israel in the land as a people, a thorn in the sides of the world. And yet you have established her, though she doesn't know you. But one day she will. And certainly no one will take her out of the land again. You have made that clear. So Lord, as we realize the days in which we live, may we not only have a good answer to every man that asks for the hope that we have, but may it move us to live a different way, to be more urgent in our desire to share our faith, to be more purposeful in our willingness to invite folks to church or to sit down and open the Bible with someone and to tell them what's coming next. May we warn them of the judgment of God, and may we encourage them with your love. Maybe this morning you're in church and your relationship with God is pretty much institutionalized. You don't know him really, but you know a lot about him. So you go to church because you feel better, but really you don't come to meet with him. And worship to you isn't singing songs to God who has saved you. It's just part of the service. And so you're a religious person without a relationship with God, and that's tragic. Because then certainly the warnings of God and the word of God won't have much of an impact either.
It won't move you. It won't minister to you. It'll be what happens to the Thessalonians, who find themselves moved by what they heard last, rather than knowing God. And God wants you to know Him. That's why He sent His Son. He didn't make you to muddle in the I don't know what ifs. He taught you His Word so that you might have an answer for the hope, and that you might have peace, and that these false teachers might be easily identified by the fact that they don't stand with God. Look, know this. God sent His Son Jesus so that you could have life with Him. And Jesus came to take the one thing that is in between you and God away, your sin, which demands judgment. So either you're going to pay for the sins in your life, and you have plenty of them, or you're going to take those and lay them at Jesus' feet at Calvary, and He's going to hand you His holiness, and you're going to go stand before the Father one day, clothed in, cloaked in, wrapped in the faithfulness of Jesus. You're either going to go in with your own clothes, which are not going to be acceptable to God, or you're going to go wrapped in the grace of Jesus. Now, if you don't know the Lord like that, then you come up and talk to one of the pastors before you go home today. And whether you're here in the sanctuary or you're over sitting in the fellowship hall, you can make your way over here. It'll just take you a couple minutes. But God will meet you. God will give you life. And then you'll be ready, not only to begin to learn what comes next, but you'll be ready when the Lord comes. And He'll gather you together with Him. And so shall you ever be with the Lord. The hope of God will be your strength then, the joy of the Lord. So you come. And if you know the Lord this morning, then may you know what comes next. May you have a good foundation for your feet. And may you commit yourself to having that through God's Word. Don't forget, remember, Paul said. Shall we stand?
We stand in awe of Your presence, and we seek Your holy name. For Your love, it is eternal. The living waters flow from You. Father in heaven, we come to worship You. Holy Spirit, teaching us to walk in You. Jesus, sweet Savior, we want to glorify You. Glorify You, Jesus, sweet Savior, we want to glorify You.
Father, we thank You this morning that we not only have a living hope in Your Son, but we have a great promise of Your soon coming. And that, Lord, the one would really support the other. We know You, we love You, we want to know You better, but we long to see You face to face. We know that when You come, that's going to be the end for many people. There's going to be then a permanent settling of unbelief and disbelief, but yet for us, eternal life. So, May knowing the days in which we live change the way we go about doing what we do. And may we not put off till tomorrow what ought to be done today. And may we be willing, Father, to be vessels that You would use in these last days, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys. Have a good day. Hope to see you tonight at 6:00.